there. This is Pastor Siva Moodley.
And I'm Pastor Jesse Moodley.
We are having such an exciting time during these live 1 hour specials. We are talking about the glory, and thank you for all the feedback we're getting. Today on the program, we're going to take you even deeper into the glory. You're going to learn some powerful revelation about the glory. So stay tuned and take down notes. And remember, if you miss anything that we teach, you can always go back to our YouTube channel and you can get it there on our YouTube channel. Get ready. Let's get into the word. I spoke about how you protect the glory. I said that the glory in your life changes your personality. And as your personality changes, it increases the glory, changes your personality again. So in other words, more and more of the glory, the more you become like Jesus.
Yes, exactly.
But you can also destroy the glory on your life. You can destroy the glory in your life. Don't worry, well, you know, she sang out of tune. She destroyed the glory in our church. No. I'm talking about the glory in your life. You know, you can go to a dead place, a dead church, and you can still be in the glory. You may not feel the anointing there, but you can have the glory on you. And so the only person that can destroy the glory on you is you. Let me say it again. You can write this down. The only person that can destroy the glory on me is me. The devil can't destroy it.
That's right.
But no one else can destroy it. Your friends can't destroy it. Even if they're not living right for God, even if the people you're around are not living right for God, that cannot destroy the glory. Only you can destroy the glory. Amen? Only you can destroy. This is why when David, when he destroyed the glory by sinning with Bathsheba,
yes,
right, and he committed murder, he did two things. He was unequally yoked, and he committed murder in the process, right? When he did that, he wrote Psalms in Psalms 51, and this is what he said. He said, chastise me.
Yeah.
Do what you want to me. But please, please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Don't let the glory leave me. But I am responsible. In fact, I was born in iniquity. That's what David said. He said, I've messed up this whole thing. He didn't say Bathsheba was having a bath in the daytime in full view. She knew I was in the balcony, and she did that in full view. He didn't say Uriah came over you, and he didn't listen to one of my plans, and therefore I had no choice. I had to get him killed. You know,
I tried everything.
I tried everything. He didn't blame those people. He said, I am responsible for destroying the glory of my life. This is what you must understand. Only you can destroy the glory that you're walking in. Only you can do it. Right? And I'm not talking about the anointing here. I'm talking about the glory. So, when the glory comes in your life, the only way you can stop the glory, you can cause it to decrease, is to become stiff-necked. So you see, Jesus continuously speaks about people opposing the glory. If it says, you brood of vipers, you stiff-necked people. And remember, Stephen said it. You stiff-necked people,
yes. You
always oppose the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus also spoke about stiff-necked people.
Exactly.
What does it mean to be stiff-necked? Stiff-necked, look at this. Stiff-necked means I don't want to change. I don't want to change. So when you're a person that says, this is my personality, this is the way I always did things, this is the way I always learned things, this is the way I grew up, this is my culture, then you are what the Bible calls stiff-necked. It means you oppose God. Ooh, that's messing up some people.
Yeah.
Let me say it again slowly. Say it again slowly. There are some people will go to church and everyone else lifting their hands and they'll have their arms folded. Why is your arms folded? Well, this is the way I was taught. So it means you're stiff-necked. You don't want to change through the glory. So you oppose the glory by keeping your old personality. Or you always did things a certain way, so you become stiff-necked to what the glory wants to do. The glory is saying, do this. You say, no, I'll oppose it. You know, maybe everyone's lifting their hands and they're worshiping God. And what are you doing when they're worshiping God? You're opening your Bible and you're reading your Bible. That is actually opposing the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, it's not your time to read your Bible.
It's not your time to read the Bible. It's the time to worship God. But when you should be worshiping God and you decide you want to, every time people are worshiping God, you start reading a Bible, that is actually opposition to the Holy Spirit. You are stiff-necked and you're opposing God. So You will see things. Another example, and you know, the Holy Spirit just put this inside me right now. When someone is under the power of God, let's just say somebody falls under the power of God and they're on the floor. When you go and lay hands on that person, you go and you pray for that person that's on the floor, you are opposing the Holy Spirit. Let me say it again, because I see this a lot of churches.
Yes.
They're ignorant to God. In fact, they're ignorant of the doctrine of laying on of hands.
Yeah.
Because laying on of hands means that there can be transference and counter-transference. Paul wrote to a pastor called Timothy, and he said to this young pastor called Timothy, don't be too quick to lay hands, lest you become a partaker of that person's sin. What was Paul saying?
Mm-hmm.
He's saying, when you lay hands at the wrong time, there's a transference of sin from that person into you. So in churches, I've seen this. I don't allow it in my church because I understand how this thing works. But when people fall down, somebody wants to go pray for them.
Mm.
You never, ever, ever pray for people on the floor. You never, ever do that. You are opposing the Holy Spirit, number one. Number two, all the stuff coming out of that person will go inside you. You never lay hands on people that are slain. If they are slain, it's called a Holy Spirit operation. The Holy Spirit is operating on them. Don't be stiff-necked and go and interfere and think that you are greater than the Holy Spirit and you want to push something through or you want to help them get a break. Don't touch them.
Mm.
Don't touch them when he is busy, because he's taking stuff out of them. And when you're going and praying, they're laying hands on that person, that stuff is going to go somewhere. Amen? So, if you're a pastor watching me, teach your people correctly. The doctrine of laying on of hands, don't lay hands on people that are under the power. Never do that. Well, what if they're not healed? Don't lay hands on people under the power. Don't lay hands on people under the power. If God says, lift them up, pray for them again, that's different. But if they're under the operation of the Holy Spirit, don't be stiff-necked and go and interfere with the supernatural. You are not greater than the Holy Spirit. You're not greater than the Holy Spirit. You are interfering with what heaven is doing in that person's life. And that stuff, I've seen it happen.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen it happen. I've seen that stuff coming out of people and going into the person that was ignorant. And that person now was suffering with the same stuff that the person that got delivered from used to suffer with. So don't lay hands until you are told by the Holy Spirit to lay hands. That's what Paul said to Timothy.
Yes.
Don't be too quick to lay hands. You have to be told by the Holy Spirit to lay hands. Amen? Even if someone is sick, the Bible says, if someone is sick, call the elders and they'll lay hands on the sick will recover. Even if someone is sick, don't just go run and lay hands. Wait for the Holy Spirit to tell you, now do it. Always be led by the Holy Spirit. If he does not speak, you don't lay hands. You don't need to lay hands on people for people to fall down. In our church, I hardly lay hands. And the power of God just hits people, they get slain. I don't need to lay hands. If he's present, he will do the miracle. So someone's watching me right now, and I just sense this in my spirit. You got very sick after you disobeyed the Holy Spirit. You laid hands on someone who was under the power they were being operated on, and that stuff has now come inside you. You need to repent of this stuff. Ask God to set you free today. Amen? Because transference of spirits is a very real thing. Don't oppose the Holy Spirit. Don't oppose the glory. Amen? Don't oppose the glory. You and I are not wiser, more powerful, more intelligent than the Holy Spirit. You and I can't alter the anointing and the miracles. He does it. He does it. Amen? He's the one that does it. Now, if your personality doesn't change, you're stiff-necked, and you want to do your own stuff, you decrease the glory.
Yes.
And the glory decreases in your life. Eventually, you become stagnant spiritually. So how does somebody on fire for God, somebody walking with God, somebody operating in dreams, somebody operating in, watch this, Somebody operating in the gifts, operating in dreams. Mm. How does somebody operating in miracles, somebody operating in the supernatural, all of a sudden become stagnant? How do you become stagnant? You become stagnant when you have opposed the glory. You've opposed the anointing. Sometimes people say, why is nothing happening anymore? Why is everything dried up? And then some fool comes and tells you, well, you're going through a season. Nonsense. Mm. Nonsense. Nonsense. Tell me, does God go on vacation? Does God go away during winter and comes back to visit you in spring and summer? No, he's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He doesn't change. If things are not right, if the supernatural, as all of a sudden, you become stagnant spiritually, you have to go back and say, where did I disobey God?
Yes.
Where did I disobey the instruction of God? And when you find that spot, you will then return to that place you used to be at before. The only time you become stagnant is when you've grieved the glory. You've grieved the glory. God said, do this. You said, no, I'm too busy. God said, do this. You said, no, I don't want to. God said, do this. You said, no, I don't want to. God said, do this. You said, I'll do it later. And then you forgot about it. Or maybe you made a vow to God and you just forgot about the vow. Now, because you've grieved the glory, you have become spiritually stagnant. Right? Spiritually stagnant. Let's go on. This is hectic stuff we're learning. Amen. Everything can be traced. Everything can be traced. Just like if you're under a curse, you can trace where the curse comes from. You can break it. If you are attacked by demons, you can trace where it comes from. If sickness is tormenting you, it's in your bloodline, you can trace where it comes from. You can deal with it. If anything that happens to you that is not God, you can always trace the source. If you in your walk, all of a sudden you become stagnant spiritually, you've stopped dreaming from God. Mm-hmm. You know, I can tell you from my own personal walk, when I started off, I used to dream every night. I would have God speak to me in dreams. It would take me places, show me stuff. I would have dreams upon dreams upon dreams. But in my young days, I didn't understand the gift of dreams. So I would tell people what God told me in the dream. Now, why would I tell them? Because no one taught me how dreams work. So I thought if you get a dream about someone, you need to go tell them. Most of the time, you are not to tell them. In fact, maybe 80% of the time, you're not to tell that person. The dream is a private conversation between God and you. It's not for you to relate to others. You can go to someone and ask them, can you help me with the interpretation? Like sometimes people come to me and they tell me this is their dream. I know exactly what it means because I have the gift for interpretation. It's in the glory realm. But maybe you have a spiritual father, spiritual mother, and they gave you a dream. And you know this dream is from God. Right? You know the dream is from God. You know, and I have people in my church, great counselors in my church, great pastors in my church. You can go to any one of them and most of the time they'll tell you, pray and ask God for the interpretation, or they'll give you the interpretation. But I didn't know that when I was a young Christian. I dreamt some bad things about people going to happen. And as I was dreaming, these things were coming to pass. So when I dreamt more stuff, I went and told people, this is what God is telling me in the dream. And because I told them the dream, because I told the person the dream stopped. I stopped dreaming. In fact, when I say I stopped dreaming from God. Mm. In fact, for several years, I had no dreams. No dreams at all. Until I matured and I realized I'm not supposed to share my dreams. I'm not supposed to. And I repented and asked God to forgive me. And when I went back, the dream gift dried up. When I went back and I repented, the dream started again. They started again. You see, when anything becomes stagnant, there is somewhere we have choked the supernatural. Always remember this. Anything becomes stagnant, somewhere we have choked the supernatural. Somewhere we have choked it. Maybe you have a business that was always blessed and God kept on blessing it. All of a sudden, all the blessings stopped. You've got to stop and turn around and say, where did I grieve the Holy Spirit? Where did I choke the blessing? Where did I do that? And you go back and you fix it and you see how the blessing will flow again. Amen. Mm-hmm. So if you want to know more about dreams, you can go into our YouTube channel. I do a lot of deep teachings on dreams and visions, and you can find it on our YouTube channel. You just got to go and search it. It's youtube.com/The Miracle Center. Or if you go to my website, silvermotley.com, you see a link there to YouTube. Click on the link and you're on that page, right? Now, so your spirit changes your soul, and your soul impacts your spirit, which in turn impacts your soul again.
In that cycle.
And so I spoke in great detail. If you miss any of the stuff, go to Sunday's teaching, right? Now, what destroys the glory? I said if you're stiff-necked, you're going to destroy the glory. There are three things the Bible is very clear about that destroys the glory of God on someone's life. If you used to operate with the glory, if you used to have the glory on you, people saw Jesus on you, you used to be in an atmosphere where gold dust would fall on people, you pray for people, and you know, money will manifest, all these things will happen. If you used to be in an environment where signs and wonders would take place, and all of a sudden it doesn't, there are three reasons. I said, because you're stiff-necked, you're grieving the Holy Spirit, right?
Yes.
But in being stiff-necked, there's three ways in which you are stiff-necked. Number one is the first thing that destroys the glory, write this down, is rebellion. Rebellion, right? Proverbs 17:11. Read that for me, Jesse.
An evil man seeks only rebellion. Therefore, a cruel messenger shall be sent against him.
Proverbs 17:11. What does it say? It says when someone, and he's talking about an evil man, right? It says when someone is rebellious, they are recipients. They're a recipient of a demon spirit. Let's read again. Read it for me again. Proverbs 17:11.
An evil man seeks only rebellion. Therefore, a cruel messenger shall be sent against him.
Yeah, right? So, rebellion, the demonic comes to you, and the demonic starts, a cruel messenger comes against you, starts to attack you. The demonic, you attract the demonic by rebellion. So you'll see when people are rebellious, when children are rebellious, when people walk in rebellion, even in the church, they walk in rebellion to spiritual authority. Whenever somebody walks in rebellion, you'll always see the demonic coming after them. It's something, it's not an opinion, it's what the Bible says. Yes. It's what the Bible says. I've seen people operating in rebellion. I've seen everything they had been taken away from them. I've seen their marriages fall apart.
Yes.
I've seen them, some of them die from sicknesses, right? And I've seen it all over the world, people in rebellion. I've seen what happens when people will not listen. When they'll not listen to the Spirit of God, I've seen how rebellion causes the demonic and gives the demonic power over them. And a typical example is King Saul.
Yes.
Because he was rebellious to the prophet, an evil spirit came against him, right? So number one, when someone is rebellious, that means they're rebellious to authority. They're rebellious in their marriage. They're rebellious in their family. They're rebellious with the people they join. They join people that are rebellious, walking in rebellion. That makes you rebellious when you join people in rebellion. They're rebellious at work, maybe. But when someone has a rebellious nature, they cause the demonic to come to them.
Yes.
And the glory is no longer there. Let me say it again. Why? Because rebellion causes the glory to depart. And when the glory departs, a demonic spirit comes. Right? Let's do it again. Let's say it again. I know some of you just joined me again. What destroys the glory? Number one is rebellion. When a person is rebellious, let's take a typical example, because most of you guys are Christians watching me on the channel. I know some of you guys are not Christians, and some of you guys maybe you're going to become Christians tonight. Amen. Glory to God. But you know, in church, when a person is rebellious, you can clearly see the demonic on them. Clearly see it on them. And you see the demonic on them. You see the anger, the hate in them. But the one thing you will not see on that person is the glory of God. You can never have a rebellious person with the glory. It's impossible. Let me say it again, again. You can never have a rebellious person with the glory on them. The glory will never, never be on a person, even on a church, on a business, on any entity that is rebellious. The first thing that happens when a person or entity is rebellious, the glory departs. And then if the person stays rebellious, the demonic comes to them. Are you with me so far? So right on number one, rebellion destroys the glory. Rebellion destroys the glory. So if you've been a rebellious person, you need to seek forgiveness, repent, go back to God, and the glory will come back. Amen? If you've been joining people who are rebellious, do the same. Because rebellion destroys the glory. Right. Number two, you say, give me another scripture for that, Pastor. Psalms 1. Blessed is the man that doesn't sit, stand, talk with the rebellious. Another one. Rebellion is as the sin of
witchcraft.
It actually is the sin of witchcraft in the original scripture, right?
Samuel.
So again, all these things kill the glory, kill the glory. So you got to ask yourself a question. How am I in my walk with God or with people around me? How do I function in the business that I own? Do I have a rebellious nature? The glory of God can't be in my business. Mm. Am I rebellious at school? The glory of God will not function with you. Maybe you got some people who are activists, and activists are not always bad people. I mean, I used to be an activist when I was young. So I still am. All right. But there are some activists that say to you, let's do some wrong things, right? Let's do some wrong things. And you get involved with these activists doing the wrong things. You start to operate in rebellion. Now the glory leaves you. It leaves you. It leaves you, right? Maybe lunchtime, during your lunchtime, you have a group of people that you have lunch with. And the group of people you have lunch with are rebellious people. And because you're with that rebellious clique, and they're talking about their rebellion to their husbands or their rebellion to the boss, whatever. Because you're with rebellious people, the glory that was on you departs from you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It departs from you. Because the glory does not stay with rebellion. So number one, rebellion. Number two, write this down. Sin kills the glory. Sin destroys the glory. So, read for me Psalms 51, verses 9 and to 11.
Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities.
Uh-huh.
Create in me a clean heart, O God,
uh-huh.
and renew a right spirit within me.
Right.
Cast me not away from thy presence.
Don't take me away from the glory.
Mm.
Don't take me away from the glory. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me.
This is
David repenting. So he said, listen, please forgive me. Class, blot out my iniquity. Blot it out. Forgive me.
Hide your face because God cannot look at rebellion.
Yes.
He won't live in rebellion.
And in sin as well. Yeah. Mm. So, beloved, if you know you're doing something that is sin, you know it. And I'm not here to judge you. Your sin is sin. It's your business. But if you know something you're doing is wrong, you don't have peace about it, that stuff, that sin is what will keep the glory away from you. Unlike the anointing will still be there, you still feel the anointing, but the glory will depart because of sin. So how do I get the glory back? I have to repent of my sin. I have to ask God to forgive me for all the wrongs I've done and ask Him to wash me in my blood. Be genuine, come before God and ask Him to make you brand new. Amen? Number three is James 1:26. And what is the third thing that destroys the glory?
It's the tongue.
Your mouth, the things that you say. Whoa. The things that you say is one of the easiest ways to destroy the glory.
Mm.
Right? The things that you say. So, read this for me.
If any man among you seem to be religious and bridles not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is vain. That's what James said, be quick
right.
to hear
so,
and slow to speak.
So watch this now. Let me give you a simple example. All of you can relate to this, right? Something you can relate to. Let's say you went to church and there's a powerful meeting. You experienced the glory of God, the anointing and so on. And the presence of God is all over you. You come home, you're full of the glory.
Mm.
You're full of the glory. Maybe you are drunk, and maybe you're with laughter, but you're full of the glory. You don't have to be drunk with laughter. You just need to be full of the glory. So you come home, you sit on the couch, you're still full of the glory. And then someone puts on the TV, and they put on a movie that is vulgar. Or maybe they put on the news. What happens the moment they switch that on?
Mm.
the glory departs, right? The anointing leaves you and it's gone, doesn't come back. Why? Because the environment you bring the glory into can cause the glory to depart. The glory is holy. It's very holy. Very, very holy. This is why Isaiah said, "Woe to me, for I'm a man of unclean lips and I dwell with people of unclean lips." When he experienced the glory, Isaiah 6.
Yes.
Right? So the glory can be quickly destroyed by environment. And one of the ways you create environment is by how you speak. Let's say you're in the glory and someone says, "Are you better now?" And you say, "No, I'm still, no, I don't think God's going to heal me." Because you said it negative, you killed the glory. You killed the glory. "Oh, I don't think anything good will come out of him." You killed the glory. "Hey, you stupid." You killed the glory. Anything you say negative, "Well, I hope I'll get healed."
"Oh, one day it'll happen.
You kill the glory immediately. Because the glory is sensitive to the words you say. It's very sensitive to the words. So you have to be so careful. Sometimes I preach, and I felt that, hey, I said something. It wasn't wrong, but I just felt in my spirit. It happened once or twice in my ministry. Mm. I said some stuff, and I felt I shouldn't have said it. So those are three quick things that destroy the glory. And there are more stuff, but these are the common things, the very common things that destroy the glory. So you have to be sensitive to how you speak. You have to be sensitive to how you speak even outside your quiet time. How do you speak on the road? How do you speak on the telephone? How do you speak on the chat groups? Maybe somebody sends you a dirty picture, pornographic picture. Do you forward it? Do you keep looking at it? Or do you rebuke it and delete it? See, all those little things that you do affect the glory in your life. Having the glory is not easy. You have to live a holy life. Having the anointing is very easy. Anybody can. Wow, what a powerful program that was. We chatted today about something that is so important and so many don't understand. Amen?
Amen?
So many don't understand. If you missed today's episode or you missed any of the previous episodes, you can go to our YouTube channel and you can watch all the previous episodes. You can get activated there. You can get the knowledge. Like the scripture says, the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory. Amen. So keep operating in the glory and keep telling us what God is doing in your life. Stay connected to this move of the supernatural. God bless you. This is Pastor Siva Modley.
God bless you. This is Pastor Jesse Modley.
We love you. Reminding you that miracles are normal. God bless you. Goodbye.
Bye.